Hi there. In this lecture, we see Bobby Fischer playing against Wolfgang Unzicker. This is in the 1959 Zurich tournament, round 8. So Unzicker was one of the very strong grandmasters in the tournament. He had been awarded the IM title in 1950, 9 years before this game, and the GM title in 1954, so 5 years before this game. So he was West German champion in 1948, 1950, 1952, 59, 63, and 65. Very, very, very strong grandmaster at the time. So Fischer playing e4. We have e5 for Unzicker. Knight f3, knight c6, bishop b5. Standard Roy Lopez stuff to start off with. So these moves all a well-trodden path. And Fischer's got some homebrew ideas here. Knight e3. And now we see d takes, knight h2. This gives f3 as a parking space for the queen. And also Fischer's use of this potential pawn sack after knight g4, knight takes, h takes. We see queen c6 and g5, which Fischer has been playing in this position. Very interesting pawn sacrifice idea. Black plays one of the strong moves just to ignore it, knight c4. If bishop takes g5, knight d5 is strong, pouncing on the bishop. And if bishop takes check, the best is actually king h8, and white can claim only a small edge here. It's still nevertheless interesting. There's a dynamic h file to play with, maybe later g3, king g2 at some point. It's dangerous in some respects. So, yeah, knight d5 is interesting. In fact, rook takes d5 is an interesting counter exchange sack. But again, white's going to end up slightly better here. So anyway, one of the best moves, knight c4, just ignoring the whole thing. Knight g4, which now officially protects that pawn. And bishop takes g4, giving up the light square bishop. Here, f6 is played. It seems as though this might be an inaccuracy, actually. White does have this light square bishop, although it is kind of hemmed in at the moment. It seems better is rook d7. So black just focusing on the dark squares like d2 and maybe putting in knight d2 at some point. So for example, g3, knight d2, this is fairly pleasant for black. Black's actually doing very well here, just entrenching a knight on d2 as an example. So yeah, rook d7's got a lot going for it. If white has to play b3 and knight d2, this is interesting, hitting e5. But black can even just ignore e5, and it's a very interesting dynamic position with a knight on d2, about even. So anyway, f6 seems an inaccuracy. It does weaken things in the long term. It weakens the 7th rank. It weakens light squares. Okay, but it's not so obvious why it's kind of would require proof. So can Fischer provide proof? So we see a4. Trying to open up the queen side. Knight b6. Instead of a4, bishop b3 is also interesting. For example, trying to play a4 here and then basically infiltrating like this. And if black can be committed to playing a move like c4, the dark squares are quite good here on this diagonal. This is better for white. But anyway, a4 is played here. Knight b6, a takes, bishop e3. Rook a8. Rook ed1, king h8, b3, bishop g7, queen h4, bishop f6, bishop g5. And now black swaps off those dark square bishops. And a pair of rooks come off. Is it going to be a peaceful draw, knight d7? In this position, this is a very, very instructive position in my view. There is a theoretical skewer. If you look at the configuration here, it's as though there's a potential skewer possibility if only a bishop was on that diagonal. It'd be quite juicy picking up material potentially, or on c6. And so this kind of theoretical skewer is interesting to consider how that can potentially rise to the surface. Fischer's next move looks completely outrageous, but it actually has possibilities of skewering in mind, rising this theoretically weak configuration into something, you know, in reality. Can you see what Fischer plays in this position if I give you 5 seconds to pause the video? He plays actually bishop d1, and you might wonder, hold on, Kingscrusher, there's a weakness of the last move. It's a neglected e4. This would be a poisoned pawn, actually. Knight f6 was played. So the bishop actually gets to reroute to e2, and you might wonder, well, if taking, what happens? It's actually, the key move is actually bishop f3 to head into that c6 square. So, for example, queen f4, we just take, and then bishop c6, and black's losing material. If rook d8, rook d1, winning material, because of this, that horrible pin, the skewer turns into a pin. And if rook e7, in this position, there's actually an instructive tactical idea. What would you play if I give you 5 seconds to pause the video? Okay, you might have been convinced that actually rook a7 is sufficient. That's not the case. Black can escape this relative pin with check. And then after knight e5, black's actually the one that's better here. It's actually rather dangerous because of things like knight g4 check, or h5, knight g4, and rook h1, almost like mating. So if bishop d7 is a safety guard for g4, you know, black's just doing better here. So in fact, on rook e7, the key move would actually be rook a8 check to try and convert the relative pin to an absolute pin here after rook a7. Because this rook e1 check, there's an absolute pin against the knight. The knight's not moving anywhere here. So we're just snapping off the knight. So yeah, some very, very instructive tactical ideas all behind the scenes. It's rather remarkable. We've got ideas of exploiting a configuration where there's skewering, and we've got a situation where there's relative pins and there's relative pins, and if possible try and convert your relative pins into absolute pins for absolute counterplay removal. So yeah, fascinating stuff all beneath the surface of bishop d1. Very instructive in my view, this move, because otherwise this bishop's just stuck on c2, without the prospect of hitting the queen side, and the whole destination of the game could be changed with that if the bishop's not central on e2. Okay. We see knight f6, and now rook a7 here, and then black's under pressure in this position. So if queen takes, queen f6 is mating. So queen d6, bishop e2, so pressure on b5, this horrible rook on the 7th. Rook e7. Here, if b4, there's another kind of skewer, rook a6, skewering the queen and knight. And this position, there's queen e3, leading into another skewer, bishop f3. Yeah, this is skewer territory, isn't it, really? Very funny. So rook e7, rook takes e7, queen takes. We see bishop takes b5. Now, this is a nice pawn to have. King g7, bishop e2, queen c7. Queen e3, now a slight inaccuracy, queen a5. More stubborn would be queen d6, it seems. After g3, h6, white does stand a little bit better, but it's quite a grind to have to do from here. After queen a5, we see g3, queen a3, king g2, queen a5. If the queen takes on b3, white just takes on c5. Possible, and that's increasing the advantage, and looking at e5, that's dangerous for black. So queen a5, queen d3, queen b6, queen c4, queen c6. And now slight inaccuracy from Fischer, bishop d3. It seems as though here it is possible to play b4, offering e4 here. Because if queen takes, knight takes, b5, this situation is winning for white. This endgame is actually winning for white. The king stepping into e4, it represents a winning position. But anyway, bishop d3 was played, queen b6, and now b4, c takes, knight g4. Fischer wants the queens off, black obliges, and f4. This is getting a little bit unpleasant now for black. After c6, two pawns up, but albeit it's double pawns here. And then the king comes onto the dark squares, and then comes back, because black's got a dangerous past pawn potential here. White can't venture too far without g5 and h4, but pawns don't go backwards, so these pawns are committed. We have g5, and now bishop e2 probing these pawns forward, and now taking, and now bishop c4. Now the king comes this way to go for that h4 pawn. Bishop f7, we have king takes h4, King takes, King g5, and the game ended here. This is a winning position. If King c5, King f6, and King takes, and for example, Bishop d5, and that's it. The King's going to come and help pawn Queen. So the game end position, yeah, very interesting. Game, King g5. The game ended here. Black resigned here. So some subtleties here. Fischer reuses his g4, g5 dynamic pawn sacrifice plan. Black's f6 might have been slightly doubtful and maybe increased White's advantage in a theoretical sense. Fischer played a very, very interesting bishop e2. That very, very interesting. It's as if the bishop was hemmed in. So this key moment later of bishop e2, I thought, was very instructive for me personally, showing that, you know, if you can look at the configuration of the opponent's position independent of calculation and see that there's something up with it, it's skewerable. It's got this skewerable property that might sort of liberate our thinking to think, you know, maybe this pawn sack in relation to the skewer we've identified, the potential downside theoretically, can rise to the surface. Those theoretical downsides rising to the surface and remains a hidden variation behind the scenes. Queen takes e4. So very, very interesting. White gets, though, significantly an advantage when the bishop's on e2, you know, hitting b5 as well as protecting d1. So this is the position which White worked with to nurture a win all the way later. So yeah, very, very interesting game. I'll take you to the game end position. So a very mature game from the young prodigy playing against a very experienced grandmaster here in 1959 and able to grind out a win. Okay. Thanks very much. Hi guys. If you enjoyed this video lecture, you might want to get more at my course, KingscrusherTV/Bobby Fischer, which I had a blast creating. Over 25 hours of video content. I tried to get the most instructive juice out of every single game covered and picking the most important games from this period. I had an absolute blast creating it, and I think you'll have an absolute blast checking it out. And it's at a big discount code with this link. You know, KingscrusherTV/Bobby Fischer has the discount code. So I hope you do check that out. Thanks very much.